reading.
No, no, I didn't. I had to until you sent it to me again.
Me either. I didn't realize I didn't write my name.
I know. So that's the reason I sent it again, because that's the only way I can tell if you're getting your email. And I want to make sure this first time.
I did it twice.
So that is
what. Did you guys all sign this?
That is what your email will look like on Monday mornings, and you will have a link there to click on. And then you'll go in and you'll put your name and your team name, or if you're just an individual, you'll click on that, and then there'll be a place for you to
record your score. So it's just a form that you fill out.
And there's usually a question at the bottom, kind of a reflection question to ask me about how you're doing, and a place where you can ask questions or make comments.
So just kind of get used to that.
I'm trying to force that habit on you, right? And
get you checking your email on Monday mornings.
So I'm just going to review a little bit. Just understand that this program is to help you with your overall wellness. We like to say up front, it's really not a weight loss program.
Because it doesn't specifically key on weight loss, but
that being said, a lot of people that participate in the program will lose weight.
Changing these simple little habits makes a big difference. And so we're looking at not just
our weight numbers, but our wellness overall. And we're going to do some reflection on that today.
And kind of try to understand that.
So you'll be competing as individuals and as teams. And at the end of the 6 weeks, those that have the highest scores will get prizes.
And then we'll switch and do a different challenge after that first 6 weeks. Part of the
reason that we meet together like this is because the research has shown that you improve more if you have a support system.
And that's part of the reason we encourage teams. And so this is basically your support system to help you be stay motivated, because it's not always easy. We're like, oh, that was good for a week or two, but now what am I going to do?
But we need someone to kind of help us and be accountable to, so that's part of the reason that we do that. So your first six-week challenge that you started today.
30 minutes of physical activity. The thing that I really want you to know is that if you haven't been active or if you struggle with any health problems, you should get the permission of a physician before you start any exercise program.
Oh man,
I don't want to be liable, or I don't want anything to happen to you, but I don't want that liability to come back to us. So we always suggest that if you feel like you need to, then you need your physician.
Talk to your physician about a exercise program. So cell phone use, and this has been a discussion, is tough.
Boo.
On some of you.
I marked down already.
And the
just a quick question.
Yes.
What if you have hands free?
Nope.
Is that still?
I did hands free. Is still no.
Okay.
And the reason that we put it in.
I'm like, ooh, I could do
yeah, that. The reason we put it in originally is that there were so many people texting. And the statistics show how many accidents are being caused by distracted driving, and texting is one of the big ones. A lot of it is we're just really conditioned, or we have a habit to pick up our cell phone when we get in the car. And sometimes we think, like I was just telling you guys, oh, I just need to talk to my mom, or I need to call my family. And that's a good time to do it because I'm busy. But
it's like it bored, and so it
keeps right. I fall asleep. I pulled over and said, just a second.
Yeah.
I pulled over and said, okay, I couldn't answer the phone.
Right. But any time that we're driving in our mind someplace else, then that is a distraction. And so our hope is that you limit how much time you're on your phone. I mean, during the challenge, you can't be on it at all. But our hope is that you'll limit it. And actually, how many times is it really a true emergency? Now, if it's a true emergency, go ahead and give yourself a point. I had someone say, what if it's the hospital calling and they need me? And I'm like, oh, okay, I guess you're going to have to do that.
Yes, I choose to ignore them.
Yes, if it's a true emergency. But that's part of the reason. We can reduce a lot of injuries and deaths and accidents if we'll start doing that. Also, anytime you manipulate a cell phone when you're driving, it's against the law. So
trying to be law-abiding, right?
The meditation. Anybody have problems with that? It's only been one day, right?
Yeah, that's one of the hardest parts. It was one of my resolutions this year, is to read more and surf the internet less.
Yeah.
I think it's damaged my attention span.
I think it has all of ours.
Yeah.
And And it's not very healthy because we're not taking that break. And so we want you to relax, meditate. A lot of the research that's coming out talks about obesity and chronic disease having to do with the fact that we have too much stress. And we can't relax, so we need to learn how to do that.
Doesn't matter what we read, though, right?
No, as long as it's uplifting.
Uplifting. Because I read in the bathtub every night.
And calming. Yeah, and calming.
Basically, they positive.
So do you have to read and meditate?
No.
It's just one or the
positive.
Other.
Okay. Yeah.
One or the other.
And 10 minutes isn't very long.
10 minutes isn't very long. And if you really want to meditate, yeah, there are some great meditation videos on YouTube that are for free. All you have to do is search, and you can do 10 minutes.
And there's some meditation apps too.
Yes.
Just don't do it while you're driving.
Yeah, don't do it while you're driving. But there's a lot out there, so it really can walk you through that and help you with that. So, okay, water's the other one. I'm going to let Kaylee talk to you about water. She's got a little presentation about water. Any questions before she jumps into that? We're pretty good.
Okay. Oh, she's going to talk about water. And then if you'll notice on your tracking sheet next week, there's an extra challenge. So you are tracking your food next week, and that is for 1 week only. It would be nice if we could track our food all the time, but it's too time intensive and everybody loses interest and it's too hard. It's just hard. But next week, we want you to track it for those 6 days. And Kaylee's going to talk a little bit about how to do that and a way to make it a little bit easier after she finishes her water.
Okay. So we're going to talk about fluids first. So there really isn't a recommendation for how much water we should be drinking each day anymore. They used to say, like, drink 8 cups of water each day, right? Do you guys remember that?
Mm-hmm. A gallon a day.
But now they just do it by fluid recommendations. And so these are the recommendations these days of what we should be drinking. And part of that, too, if you want to see the definition up there of our total fluid intake, does come from our foods as well. But only about 20% of that, so you don't want to really rely on that. But men should be getting 3.7 liters a day, so that's like 15 and a half cups, quite a bit of cups of fluids. And then women, 2.7 liters. And then the kids, we don't have any kids here, so we won't go over that one. But we're asking that you drink the 8 cups of water a day, because water is really good for you. And it's good for a lot of reasons, and we're going to talk about what it does for your body. But plain water also is great for you because it's inexpensive, it doesn't have any calories, and it's really always available to us, and our body does need it to do certain things. So that's why we're asking that you drink the 8 cups of water a day. And you should still have room, according to the fluid recommendation, to drink other things as well, and with your food too. So just keep that in mind. Do you guys have any questions about the recommendations before we move on? No? Yes.
Oh, do you recommend Milford tap water?
Milford tap water?
Used to.
I
do not drink Milford tap water.
Is it not good?
Is it nasty?
I drink it.
I drink it.
I like the taste of it.
I drink it through my refrigerator that filters it.
Yeah, I can't drink it straight from the tap. I have to drink bottled water.
I don't know what your guys' water is here.
It's not good.
I'll leave that up to you. But plain water really is great to drink. But one thing I did forget to say on the other slide, that your things like coffee and your sodas and teas, they do contribute to your fluid intake for the whole day, but they do contain that caffeine and the unwanted calories that we want, that you don't want. So that's why you kind of, if you're having trouble getting your water, maybe you have to start cutting out some of those things too. But the things the water helps our body do is it keeps your temperature normal, which is super important. It helps lubricate and cushion your joints. It's what helps protect your spinal cord. It helps get rid of your waste, and your blood is also made up of water. So It's used to transfer all the nutrients and oxygen to all the rest of your body. So water really is important. And our body, excuse me, our body is made up of water too, a big portion of it. So it really is important just to be drinking that plain water. But there are times too that you need more than the recommended fluids, because when you're doing like these things up here, you have to be drinking more to accommodate for like the sweating and things like that. So anytime you're physically active, so you should even be drinking more water now that you're being physically active 30 minutes each day, right? Anytime it's hot weather, right, we usually feel like drinking when it's hot, but it's also just as important to drink when you're cold, in the cold environments, because you don't feel like drinking as much, so you don't drink as much, but it's still really important to get those fluids. Higher altitudes, if children and elderly need more water, anytime you're sick you need more fluids, if you're pregnant, if you're drinking alcohol or having caffeine, just because they're mild diuretics, so they make you want to urinate, so your body has to accommodate for that too. And then just anytime that you're thirsty too, if you're thirsty, make sure you're getting that water. Because if your body's thirsty, then you're already going into like dehydration a little bit. So tricks to drinking more water. So these are some things that I came up with that can help you guys drink more water. But the thing that I think is most important is to always have it with you. Because if you carry a water bottle around with you, then you're more likely to drink it too. But do you guys have any tips or tricks that you like to do to drink water?
A good old mug at the beginning of the day, full of ice and water.
Yeah, make sure it's full and have it with you, right?
If I add flavor, I would tend to drink it more.
If you add flavor.
Sometimes water is raw.
Yeah, and we have to be kind of careful with the flavor too, because some of the flavors can add those calories and things that we don't want. But flavors like lemon wedges or lime wedges, cucumbers, things like that, they're not going to add those unwanted calories too. Something that I really have noticed the difference with me drinking water is just using a water bottle with a straw. I tend, like, if I carry it around with a straw, I sit there and I sip on it more and I drink more throughout the day. So it's really just simple little tricks, and you have to find out what really works for you too. Yes?
I found that when I bought the thermos mug that kept it cold, like for 2 days, I could put ice in that and it'll still be, I found that I drank more because it was always cold.
I do that same thing too. So that's a great thing. And
I like it warm too.
You like it?
I mean, not warm, but not cold.
But not freezing cold, right?
I had a friend that would like number her water bottles for each day.
For each day.
So that she made sure she drank.
Drink a certain amount. Yeah. And if you're really having problems and can't remember to drink your water each day, like send an alarm on your phone or a reminder to come up like every 2 hours that just tell you, I need to drink a cup of water. So just do whatever's going to work for you. Because 8 glasses of water is a really reasonable goal. Because we need so much more fluids than that each day. And we might have to cut out some of the things that we like to drink, right? But it's important to me making sure to get that plain water in. And do you guys have any questions about water before we talk about tracking our food? Okay. So like Cindy was saying, next week we get to track our food for the whole week. And sometimes people think this can be kind of a task, but there are a couple reasons that we're asking you to track your food. So insight, when you track your food, it gives you just a look at what your eating habits are and how much you're eating, and even times like why you're eating and when you're eating. So we're never gonna see this. So this is just gonna be all for you and your knowledge, but it really does help you too. So accountability and awareness, it just helps you make you aware of what you're putting in your mouth. So maybe instead of sitting down with that whole bag of potato chips and eating the whole thing while we're watching a movie, work thinking, oh, I'm gonna have to write this down, and I don't want to put that I ate a whole bag of potato chips down, so maybe I'll just have a handful. So it really does help you to make better choices as you do get more into it. And it can help eliminate that mindless eating as well. It can also help you recognize if you're eating balanced meals or not. You might realize that you're missing some nutrition, and getting all those different food groups is so important. And if you don't know what the recommendation is for the food groups, you can go to this choosemyplate.gov, and it will tell you what the current recommendations are for you and your age group too, of how many servings of the fruits, vegetables, grains, protein, and dairy you should be getting each day. And then it can also help you see problem areas like emotional eating, or even if sometimes if you're having like things that are upsetting your stomach and you're just not realizing what you're eating, it can help you with that too. But the big thing is why we're doing it this next week is just to help make you guys aware of your eating choices and what you are putting into your body. And it is a little time consuming, but there are some different things that you can do to make it easier. So you can track however you'd like, but these are some easier ways to do it. I think the easiest way is through an app if you have a smartphone. The one that I really like is the MyFitnessPal. I've tried the MyPlate calorie counter too, but I prefer the MyFitnessPal better, or prefer it more. But you can even just search like food tracker apps in your app store, and it brings up a whole bunch of them. But the MyFitnessPal, I'm just gonna show you. So this was part of my day yesterday. So it's really pretty simple. You know, this is kind of how it looks when you get your account made, but you just have to click on it to add your food, and then this little screen will come up and you just search for your food. Some things that I really like about this app is you can like search for different brands. Like I like the Light and Fit yogurt, so I search for that brand, and so I know that's exactly what I eat. You can also clear at the top, if you see that little scanner thing. You guys see that clear at the top? In here up at the corner. So you can click on that too and scan your food, and it will just bring it right up too. And you can put however many servings you want to. So that's an easy way to track your food too. But the important thing about tracking your food is to make sure to track everything you eat, because it's not going to help you if you only track a little bit each day or miss certain things. So it's important to make sure to like do it after you eat, so at every meal. So track after you have breakfast, after you have lunch, after you have dinner. Make sure you include your snacks. Don't forget any extra drinks that you drink, like that Coke that you like. So make sure to do everything. And you can't forget the little things too, like if you put butter on your toast for breakfast, you have to put the little butter in there too, because all those different calories do add up, and so you can see where you are each day. And another one that is really awesome is the Super Tracker, and this is from the government website, the choosemyplate.org, and this is their tracker. They don't have an app, unfortunately. But I suggest just even tracking your food on here one day, because I'm going to show you how neat this is. And if they had an app, this is the one I would use. So first thing you're going to do, see what I'm doing here. So you're just going to go in here, and you can just Google Super Tracker to bring up this website too. But I would try at least one day of doing this, because it has some really neat things. So to create your profile, you just have to have a couple different things: your name, age, sex, just that information. And this really helps you personalize your calorie limit and plan out like your food, of how much servings you should be having each day. And this is what is really recommended research-based recommendations too. So after you do that, you're gonna have a profile, and I'll just log into mine if it will go.
And all these apps are free?
Yes.
So you don't have to pay for them?
Yes.
If you have a Fitbit, you can also track your food on Fitbit, but it's not as user-friendly as some of the others.
I just wanted to show you guys some cool things that this website can do. And you do have to get on the computer or like an iPad, or I guess you can actually do it from your phone too. I wasn't thinking that, but you can do it from your phone. It's just not an app. But if you go over up here to my plan, let's see, and I just put my new information in yesterday, so you guys can see all my stuff. It will show you what you're supposed to be eating each day. So for mine, since I'm in my second trimester of pregnancy, my calories are quite high. But so it shows me how many calories I should be eating each day. My grains are actually higher because I am pregnant too. But so I should have 8 ounces of greens, 3 cups of vegetables a day, 2 cups of fruits, 3 cups of dairy, 6.5 ounces of protein foods, and then 7 teaspoons of oils per day. So it really just helps you know what you should be eating. And then if you go to track your food, you just go to Food Tracker over here and click on that. And it's really simple, just like the apps, to search for your food. You just come down here in the search bar. Let's say I had an apple. And it will come up with all these different ways you could have it. I don't know if you guys, it's kind of a little blurry up there. But I just had a raw apple as a little snack. So you click on that. And then you have to choose when you ate it. And maybe you can choose the amount too. And then all you do is click add. And it will add it in there. And you can see that it puts it on this little chart too, so you know where your food is. So I'm gonna go back. I put all my food in that I ate yesterday so that I could just show you guys this. How neat it looks. So this is why I think you should at least do it for one day, because you can kind of see where you're missing in your nutrients too. And one day might not be a really good accurate day, but you can see like yesterday I was low in my greens, and I needed more whole grains than I ate. I was pretty good on my fruits, my vegetables, my dairy. I was really close on them. But my protein, I ate almost double the amount of protein as I should be eating. So it just helps you realize where you're missing your nutrients too. And then these little graphs here at the bottom to show you like your sugars, your saturated fats, which are the fats you don't want, and your sodium too. So that's kind of what it helps you do. And then it will show you your calorie limit and calculate how many calories you've eaten and how many you have remaining for the day as well. So I think it's just a good picture of what you're getting through the day. But if you don't want to use the Super Tracker or an app, you can always just use a notebook and a pencil to carry around with you as well. You're not going to get maybe all the information about the calories and things that you use that the apps and the Super Tracker will provide, but it still will show you what you're eating and give you some of those insights about your eating habits as well. If you're not sure too about like serving sizes and things, get those measuring cups out and actually measure your foods, because sometimes you might think this looks like one cup, but really when you measure it, you're at a cup and a half. So yeah, it's better to be more accurate too. Do you guys have any questions? No? Just one more slide then. Oops. So just some tips for next week. It's easier to do it as you go, track your food as you go, because if you get to the end of the day and you don't remember exactly what you eat, so it's easier to do it as you go. And if you don't have time to sit there and put all your food in right then, maybe just take a quick picture of your food before and what your food looked like afterwards so that you know how much you ate too. Make sure to measure your food if you're not sure on the serving sizes and how much you're eating. Make sure you just track everything because it really does make a difference. And then don't forget your extras and just really be honest with yourself, because you're not going to get those insights and awareness about your food if you're not honest with yourself, because we're not going to see them. It's just for you. No one else will see them. Do you guys have any
of these? We need two more. First thing on your paper is I want you to think about why you're here. And it might be that, oh, my family member talked me into it, or my coworker talked me into it, and that's fine. But there's got to be another reason why you're here. So on your paper, I want you to fill it out and just a sentence or two of why you're really here. What's the purpose of you being in this program? Just like little kids all the time are saying, why?
Yeah.
We're the same way. We have to have a reason. And when we understand that reason, then our success rate is higher. And so much about our program is awareness, that we really want you to think about why you're here and be aware of that. So it's important that we know. A couple of other things is we all come into. First of all, does anybody want to share why they're here?
Learn how to be healthy and maybe lose some weight.
Okay. Anybody else?
Get me off the couch.
Learn to understand how all it works, like the food and stuff, because Mary Jo is good at that, but I never know how many calories or stuff.
So a lot of knowledge. We all need knowledge,
yeah.
Right?
My goal is to be able to breathe and tie my shoes at the same time.
That's a good thing, right?
Oh,
breathing is good.
Yes, me too.
Breathing is good.
Tie your shoes in the middle, not on the side.
Right?
Is that the bonds.
So basically, we all.
She's trying to learn to, so she can tie them in the middle and not on the side.
Right. So the stages of change, and this is kind of, I think this is interesting. So we all come into it in a different place in our stages of change. And the first one is pre-contemplation. And so pre-contemplation means that you're really like, well, it's not really my fault. Why would I care? It's just the way I am. There's a lot of resistance there. You're kind of rebelling. You're trying to rationalize. You're really reluctant. Most of you are past this stage or you wouldn't be here. Right? So yeah, there still may be a little bit of that there, but most of you are past the pre-contemplation. You're like, oh, yeah, okay, so maybe I need to do something. So that next one is contemplation. You're aware of the problem exists. You're just not really ready to take action. You're like, oh, one day I'll go to Zumba. Yeah, maybe I will show up. Who knows? Or I know I should, or I need to do this. So that's kind of the contemplation stage. And if you're there, our goal is to help you examine the benefits and get past that barrier to change so that you can move on. So we have a few goals as we go through. The other one is preparation, and that's where you're like, I've got to do something. I can't breathe and tie my shoes, I've got to do something. Or what can I do and how can I change? And at that point, you're really motivated to take that change, and we're hoping that you're almost at least to that one. So that you can say, okay, I'm ready. I can identify some change strategies so that I can move on. The next one is the action stage, and that means, oh, I've started using the stairs more, I've started drinking more water, you know, those kinds of things. I'm making changes that other people can see. And that's kind of what this program is all about. If you're not to that one yet, that's where we're hoping you get after at least the end of this first 6 weeks, is that you're ready to take action and you are taking action and so that people can see that. And the goal here is that we can reinforce those positive. positive steps and those positive behaviors so that you can become better. If you're to the maintenance stage, which some of you might be, some of you might be to the maintenance, that means that I'm usually exercising or I always eat healthy. I'm not there yet. Excuse me. And I've established a new behavior. So is there a behavior that you've established that's healthy that you've been doing for a while? There probably is. Think about it. There's probably at least one.
Yes? No?
Mm-hmm. The behavior of the water is not a problem to me.
Right.
Now the food that I put in when I'm drinking that water,
yeah,
is a whole different story.
So it might be. But that's our maintenance stage. That's where we want to get by the end of this program. We want to be maintaining some of those habits. Now the last stage that it talks about is our relapse. And it's important to know that it happens. And it happens to everybody. Life happens. Normally when we go through this, I have people that sign up and, I mean, a lot of things go on in their life in 5 months. A lot of really hard things and some struggles. And so they relapse and they go back. But the important thing to know is that you can relapse. Oh, now you're getting my text. I'm not seeing it. That's
oh.
Good. It's important that even though we relapse and we forget those behaviors for a while, then what we have to do in that stage, the goal there, is to figure out how to get back on track. Quit falling off the wagon, right? Or when we do fall off, to get back. So on your sheet, under that stages of change, I want you to just kind of circle or put an X in that box. Where do you think you are? Where do you think you are in that stage of change right now? Because it's important to know where you are and to see if you're ready. See how close you are to ready. And if you're not, if you're in the pre-contemplation or the contemplation stage, we want to be able to move you forward and help you do that. So it's interesting to know where you're at. So the next thing I want you to do is, this is kind of a reflection exercise. How do you define health and wellness? What's the definition of good health?
Just a good diet and exercise.
Okay, diet and exercise.
What else?
Be able to keep up with my kids.
Yeah. Feel like you can keep
like
up with
your stress. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Feel good.
Manage stress, feel good. So for everybody, it's just a little bit different. There's a wide variety of how we define wellness, health and wellness. So I want you to, yes?
I think in that wellness vision, you know, I look at, I know the things that I need to do about weight, and I, you know, I do the water, and I need to change my eating habits, but I think one of my biggest downfalls is my rest. Getting adequate rest.
Especially when you're working nights.
You know, and I think that plays a big part in my unhealthiness, because my work habits, and not even when I'm working. I'm a night hawk. I am awake all hours of the night. I don't sleep well. And so I think that if I can fix that, everything around that will improve.
Yeah. Yes, and it's interesting, the research I've been reading lately is if we're just concentrating on sleep. If we concentrate on sleep, a lot of those other habits start to follow and we don't even have to think about it. We just automatically start to eat a little bit better, or we automatically start to exercise. So it doesn't have to be this big change. But so what I want you to think about here is, what's your vision? If you want to draw a picture of your artsy, you can. But what's your vision? What would your life be like if you were healthy?
Oh,
what does it look like? You know, she mentioned, oh, I can stay up with my kids.
I can't even think.
It's hard, isn't it? But
yeah.
We want to see, oh, where are we trying to get? Because if we don't know where we're trying to get, we're never going to get there.
I'm not ready to be old yet. I want to be able to do stuff, so I'm like, okay.
Yeah, so maybe your vision of wellness is to be able to continue what you're doing right now.
Which is nothing, so
maybe change that.
Okay,
I've got it to you.
So be more specific. So either draw a picture and write down, what is your wellness vision? What does it look like? What are you able to do? I had someone in another program a few years ago that said, I want to hike with my family. That's what it looks like. And so for them, it was. That's what it looked like.
Yes, they still want to play. They want to still be able to play.
Right. I'm like that. I'm like that too. I still want to be able to do certain things.
Fun things that you used to do.
Mm-hmm. I want to be able to be active still.
Yeah.
And so that's part of my vision of wellness.
So what's yours? Because again, if you don't know what it looks like, you can't get there. Or you'll never know when you're right. Right? Anybody want to share a little bit of their vision?
You know, when I was younger, my vision was to look a certain way.
Right, which I could be
certain,
so.
To wear a certain size.
Mm-hmm.
You know, now it's to be healthy, to, you know, to be able, what Mary Jo says, to be able to do what we want to do, to be able to get up in the morning and spring up on our feet and just
feel good.
And feel good. Oh, I just
yeah.
want to feel good.
Mm-hmm.
I don't care how I look now. I care how I feel.
Right.
Although I want to look, you know, obviously,
yeah, everybody
if I drop
wants to
I'm going
nice.
To feel better. So weight loss is not, you know, to
right.
me it's not all about, because I taught my kids growing up, and I mean, in their heads, and I feel bad. I had four girls, and all they ever heard me say was, I'm fat, I'm fat, I'm fat, I'm fat. Well, how are they today? You know, they're the same way. That's what
mm-hmm.
I put into their heads. It wasn't about how can I be healthier? How can I do better? How can I, you know, and so they struggle with it as well now. And I did that to them, you know, and they'll tell me that. Your fault, Mom.
Well, we're not all perfect.
So,
right? We do
know,
the best we can.
Yeah,
yeah,
we with
yes.
age comes wisdom.
That
is
pretty much
serious.
That isn't really, I mean, they're going to learn that somewhere else.
They will.
But great insight that you know
does.
That now.
Yeah.
You know,
yeah.
and you have that insight.
That's not your vision now. It's
no,
changed.
As you get older, you do
change.
Change.
Yeah.
That's
yeah.
All
yeah.
Now, it's, now it's just wanting to be able to do stuff still that you didn't before.
But there might be part of your wellness vision that says, I'm going to Hawaii, which would be really nice, right?
Oh, yes.
And I want to look okay in my bathing suit. I mean,
see, that might be okay.
That's gone.
Yeah. But it's different from everybody. It's different for everybody. So I think that's why we need to take the time to really reflect and figure out what it is. Okay, so this next one that we're going to talk about is reasons to change. So there's two boxes at the bottom of your handout. One says reasons to change and one says reasons not to change. Which is the easiest to fill out?
To change.
Change. Is it? There's not a whole bunch of reasons to not change?
I think it's easier to write not to
for
so me,
what
anyways.
So, what are some reasons it not to change?
Who likes to eat vegetables all the time?
Who
I
likes
mean,
to eat vegetables all the time.
Well, yeah.
I enjoy,
most
true,
yeah.
I enjoy
so
my
lazy.
Carbs. I'll just say
I
yeah.
have it in my head that I want to do something, but I can't. I don't have the motivation to do it.
Reason to change.
I'll try it one
change,
time and be,
so
oh, that's too hard. I'm not. I can't do
it's
it.
It's hard.
It is hard.
And so I quit.
It's hard.
So
I think that's something that we have to understand.
Yeah.
It's hard.
Yeah.
If change was easy, everybody would do it.
Yeah.
If change was easy, everybody would do it. And
mm-hmm.
is that the truth? No. We're a very unhealthy population.
I am very good at making excuses not to do things.
Yeah.
Well, even to like to eat healthy, you have to like really kind of plan it out. It's not just something you can go home and
yeah.
be like,
yeah.
what? You know what I mean? Like
just before you just grab anything.
Right.
Yeah.
yeah. You're not
and
worried
a lot
about.
Sometimes it's easy to stop at McDonald's.
Oh yeah.
Kind of it's like a big head
on
the
paper.
It's
good.
It is.
And
one of the things about making changes and being healthy that they always talk about is people aren't going to make the healthy choice unless it's also the easy choice. And so we have to change our environment sometimes to make it the easy choice.
Can stick a spoon in it.
There you
so
see.
On your
yep.
sheet, one or two reasons why you should change. Why you should change. And it might be tied into a little bit of your wellness vision. But what are the reasons that you're willing to make this change? Again, why are you here, right? and along with that is, what are your values? You know, what do you value the most? A lot of people will say, oh, I value my good health. Yet they're not willing to do the things that will get them that comfort.
Just like when I'm sick, you know, you're just like, oh, just
right.
to feel good.
Right.
Again, you know, you just take it for granted.
And when you're sick, that's when you're in that relapse stage.
Yeah.
Because you really can't do anything right there, and so then you have to pick up and start again.
Yeah.
Okay, another thing that we talk about with change and making those positive behavior changes. How important are some of these goals to you? Now, I've kind of made some of these goals for you because I've kind of said, okay, you need to drink water and you need to exercise. But again, you would not have signed up and paid your money if there wasn't a reason behind it. So how important is it to you on a scale of 1 to 10, 10 being
very, very important, and one not being so important. And this is really all about priorities.
Well, because we're going strong right now, of course it's going to be a 10, because
yeah.
we're right now,
later
we're, going to, this, we're going to do this, but
as time,
but
goes,
is
on,
it might,
as time goes on, we will see.
Yeah.
Right. Right. So I work a little bit with the prison population, and is it important for them to change and to meet their goals? You bet it is, but how hard is it for them to do it?
Mm-hmm.
And so is it really that important? Is it really something you value if you're saying it's a 10 and 2 weeks later you're done? It's probably really not a 10. And the thing when we look at this is, if you're putting a 3 or a 4 on how important it is, your success rate's going to be really low. If you're at that 7, 8, 9, 10 range, then your success rate is looking a lot better as far as meeting your goals and making those changes. Again, same scale. How confident are you that you'll be successful? So when we look at this, we tend to say, well, I've made New Year's resolutions for 100 years, and I've never stuck with them. There's no way I'm going to be successful. There's no way I'm going to change. There's no way I'm going to lose this extra weight. There's no way I'm going to take the initiative to exercise. If that's the way you're feeling, your confidence level is down in those bottom ones. But on the other hand, I want you to think about, you have been successful at some point, right? You've been successful with a regular exercise program, or you've been successful with eating healthy or taking care of yourself. So think about that. When was a time that you were successful? And what did you have to do in order to be successful? So what's your confidence level? Because again, although change is difficult, it's possible. And we have to know that it's possible. And this is where that whole, you know, any little change makes a huge difference. Now, if you come out of this first week and you don't have perfect scores every day, understand that that's normal. We don't have to be perfect, we just have to be working on it. Taking one day at a time, one step at a time, and understanding that those small behaviors that you're trying to change are huge and can make a big difference. So look at that again. If you're at that bottom, if your confidence level is at that bottom, you're going to struggle probably. So that's when you need to use this support system and the tools that we can give you, some of the knowledge to improve your confidence level so that you can be successful. This is our last one. We're getting close to our 6 o'clock hour. We did start just a little bit late. But just about habits, and I will give you more about habits in an email. But there's this habit loop. There's usually a cue or a trigger that causes us to do some sort of action or routine, and then we get a reward for it. And if we get a reward, we're going to keep doing it. So if your cue or your trigger is when I get off work and I walk into the house and I think, oh, I am so exhausted, I need a break, I'm going to sit down and look at Facebook and eat chocolate. Okay, so I might do that occasionally. If that's my cue to walk in the house, my routine or my action is to sit down and do Facebook and eat chocolate, then what's my reward? Well, chocolate makes me feel better, and that's my reward. Am I going to keep doing that? Yeah, because it makes me feel better. And your brain will make almost any routine action into a habit because it doesn't have to think as hard. So the key here is to change the routine or the action, not necessarily the cue or the reward. So if I walk in the house after work and think, oh, I'm really tired, it's going to help if I exercise. So I immediately change into my exercise clothes and I exercise. Then maybe I can sit down and relax for a minute and I'm still going to get that reward. So the trick here is to change the cue. No, change the routine or the action to keep the cue and the reward. Does that kind of make sense? So we're trying to establish those habits. Make it simple. If you don't have a habit now, make it simple. Maybe get out your shoes in the morning and sit them by your bed. And know that when you get out of bed, you're going to do this. put on my shoes and went to exercise. Or know that, so this happens to me at work all the time, about 10:30, 11 o'clock, I get hungry. So I go to my drawer, which has treats.
I'm not the only one that has a drawer.
It does have healthy, like, wheat thins and a few things like that in it.
But do you grab
I do
wheat thins?
Until I want the chocolate.
My drawer does not have wheat thins in it.
Yes. But see, that's how you're going to change.
Right.
You're going to put something healthy in it. But when I get hungry about 10:30 or 11, and I just started doing this, instead of just grabbing something out of the drawer and starting to eat it, then I get up and I walk around for a few minutes. And then I can sit down and I'm okay. I can go back to what I was doing. I just get bored.
Yeah.
So it's emotional eating, obviously. But cues can be something in your environment. Well, I'm watching TV and they just had a commercial about pizza. Oh, that sounds pretty good. That could be a cue.
Gave us one, thanks.
Yeah. or it could be, oh, we're with our friends, and when I go with my friends, we always get a Diet Coke. Whatever, you know. Or I'm kind of feeling tough today. Maybe I need potato chips or whatever it is. Okay? But if you change those cues, oh, when I go with my friends, we always park clear out on the end of Walmart, and we walk in and we get our extra steps. You see how those cues work? I mean, it can be a lot of different things. So like I say, our goal is to find a cue that works, get a healthy routine in there instead of an unhealthy routine, and then still find something that can reward you. And maybe it's like, oh, if I do this for so many weeks, I get a new pair of shoes. We try not to use food as a reward because that is counterproductive. But maybe I get to play a video game.
Get back to my clothes.
Yeah. That's the reward, right? I get to go shopping. You know, so, and it doesn't have to be big. It just has to be a small reward that makes you feel good. And a lot of time it's just that I feel good that I followed through and I actually exercised today. That's a reward in and of itself. So this is just kind of the information that we want to give you tonight, kind of help get you started. What questions do you have for us?